Hello everyone, welcome to the video presentation on design of a single cell RCC box girder bridge. We have drawn a 3D model of the superstructure that we are going to design today, which you can see on the screen. In designing the superstructure, we will use the computer aided modeling software SAP 2000 version 15 and 15.2. With these softwares, mostly we will try to obtain the values of design moment, shear and torsion, and later on with these values we will calculate the reinforcement manually. Now let us see the design specifications. The bridge length is 100 feet with 32 feet, two lengths, each length 12 feet. The concrete composite strength FC prime 4 KSI and the steel yield strength 60 KSI. Code has included a new convention DC and DW. DC stands for the dead load of the structural components. The unit weight of the concrete is 0.15 kcf. Wearing surface, DW stands for the dead load of the wearing surface. It is 0.015 kcf, and post and rails, this which you have calculated, is 0.41 kLf. We'll use the design vehicle HL93 with a dynamic load allowance of 33% of the live load. We'll use the Astro LRFD 2012 Bridge Design Specification 6th edition as our design code. And as per the code, we'll use the load modifier 1. Load combinations. While we'll design the deck, we'll use the service limit state 1 with a load combination 1, dead load of the structural component 1, dead load of the wearing surface and 1 live load and impact load. While we design the girder, we'll use the strength limit state 1 with a load combination of 1.25 dead load of the structural components, 1.5 dead load of the wearing surface and 1.75 live load and impact load. This is the typical section of Astro PCI American Segmental Bridge Institute 2100. The dimensions are shown here. Let us see a pictorial view. This is the typical cross sections with width of 32 feet. The thickness of the deck is 9 inch. Thickness of the bottom slab is 8 inch and the thickness of the web is 10 inch. And the important dimension is the overhang length is 6 feet 9.75 inch. The other dimensions are shown on the screen. While doing the design of deck, we'll perform the transverse analysis and we'll do that in SAP 2000 version 15. We all know that the deck behaves like a two-way slab. When a static concentrated load is applied on the deck, the deck deflects both in longitudinal and transverse direction. Hence, if we do the 3D frame analysis, that will be the most accurate one. But 3D frame analysis is a tedious job and it is seldom done. Instead of that, a common practice is to perform a 2D frame analysis considering the unit length of the structure. That will simulate the 3D frame analysis. But here, important to note that we need to put the resultant 3D load into a 2D frame. So we'll follow the same procedure. Now we need to consider the critical load configurations. We need to say that we need to put the load in some strategical points which will create the worst case situations. Suppose this is the one load configuration where we put the rear wheel of a vehicle. The outermost wheel is placed at a distance 1 foot from the toe of the barriers, and this will create the maximum negative moment at the overhang. With the same load configurations, we will also find the maximum negative moment in bottom slab. Now this is another load configuration. If you put the two vehicles at the center separated by a distance of 2 feet moment at the center line slab. With the same load configuration, it will produce the maximum negative moment in top slab base of the web. This is the third load configuration, where the two vehicles are placed at the extreme location, having these outer wheel 1 feet from the toe of the barriers, and this will produce the maximum negative moment at the center line slab. Now let us go to the SAP 2000 version 15 for the 2D modeling, and we'll perform the 10-bus analysis there. This is SAP 2000 version 15, though an older version, even though it will suffice. Let us select a blank template. Now we have to edit the grid data. In selecting the grid data, we have considered that grid data should be so distinct it facilitate our drawing of the frame, at the same time it facilitate the assigning of the loads on the frame. As such, we have already calculated the grid data along x-axis and z-axis. So I am just putting the values here. Suppose along the x-axis, grid data alpha, the value should be 4 feet. Along B, the grid data should be 2.085 feet. As such, to make a shortcut, I like to make a time jump so that the viewer can see the values after I complete entering the values. So you can see these are the grid data that I have given in along the z-axis. I'm sorry, during the recording I found that my mouse is a bit sluggish, so I'm afraid it will cause enough distraction among the viewers. I'm hoping that the viewers will bear it up. Okay, that's all the defining the grid system. Now we don't require this window, so I'm just closing it. So you can see the grids. Before I draw the frame, I need to define the materials. So material is 4000 psi, it's okay. Then I need to define the section properties, the frame section. We have to add new property, concrete section rectangular. We give the name deck. And its depth is 0.75 feet, and width is the unit length, that is 1 feet. Concrete reinforcement. Design type should be beam. Okay. And here is the cross sections of my deck. Okay. I make a copy of that property, then put the name web, and its depth is 6.789 feet, width remains same. Okay. So these two are the frame properties, deck and web. Okay, now I can draw. I'm selecting the bar. So first I'll draw the deck. So deck is selected here. I'm drawing the deck.
bottom slab. So I have completely drawing the deck and got the web. Web is selected. Another web. So I have completed the drawing of the frames. Now just aligning the frame in the transverse direction. To facilitate the further assignment of the loads, I have to join few of the frames together like these three. Now I go to the edit section, edit lines, join frames. So you can see the line is joined. Again, I like to divide this frame into equal parts so that I can identify the center line of this whole frame. Now again going to the edit, edit lines and divide frames, dividing into two parts. So you can see it is divided into two parts and I can very well identify the center line of this frame. Now I like to assign the boundary condition of this frame, joint, and I like to assign rest train with the hinge support here. I like to put a hinge support here, and again selecting this joint and assigning the roller support here. Now I will define the load patterns. Deadwood is already there, so I will put the post, which is a live load, and then curb, which is also a live load, wiring surface, right load, and we will include two traffic group. Three traffic group 1, traffic group 2, and finally traffic group 3. Okay. I like to see the level names of my frame. It will require for defining the path, so I'm checking the levels here so I can see the name numbering of my frame. Now we'll define the moving loads. First the path, so I'm adding new path. You can see the frame numbering. So I'm path 1, adding this one, then 2, then 11, then 12, then 6, and then finally 7. Maximum discretization length, I'm putting it 2 feet. Okay. So I have defined only one path for our transverse analysis. Now I'll define the vehicles. We'll use the HL93 our design vehicles, and fixed length. We will not use an uniform load, we will use the XL load 32. 32 should be 32,000 kip XL load. Adding this one. Again, I need to define the moving loads and vehicle classes. So adding new class, vehicle class 1, only one vehicle I have, so I'm adding this one. Okay. Okay. Now I need to define the load cases. Apart from this, I have to add additional new load case, which will be the any wing load for the analysis of influence line, giving the name moving load. Load case type, it will be moving load. Nothing to change here. Minimum loaded path 1, maximum loaded path 1, and I'm adding this one. You can see the path 1. Okay. We'll now assign load on the frames. So first selecting the point load on the the post road, and here I'm going to the assign joint load and forces. So it will be post pound feet. We have calculated that our post load is minus 441.66 pound. Okay. You can see the post load. Now I will assign the carb load, selecting this one and this one, assigning frame loads. Should be distributed load, and here we put the name curve global, and it should be 150 PSF. Okay, you can see also the carb load. Now we'll assign the wiring course, selecting this one. This one, assigning frame loads, distributed, it should be wiring course, and the value is 1.25 PSF. Now I will assign the traffic group load. The first load is, we have to select this, then assign frame load, and it should be the point load. Selecting traffic group 1, and from the left distance it should be 16,000 pounds. So we have to put the absolute distance from the end. We put the value 1 feet here and add to the existing load. Okay. For the other wheel, we have to select this frame. Then assign frame load. This is point load. Add to existing, and from the left distance it should be 4.92 feet, same amount of load. Okay. Now the load of this vehicle is also included in the traffic group 2 also, so we will assign this this load to traffic group 2 also. So here it put traffic group 2, and from the left distance it should be 1 at 2 existing loads. Okay, while selecting this frame, assign frame load point loads traffic group 2, it should be 4.92 feet from the net, same amount of load, and add to existing loads. Okay, for the traffic group 2, we have to assign the vehicle load on the other side also. Here we have to select this frame and again assign this point load. Okay, add to existing. From the left hand we have to put 1.085 and the same amount of load. Okay, for the other wheel we have to select this frame and assign frame load, point load, and it should be 5 feet from the left distance. So this is what the load configuration for the traffic group 2 looks like. Now group 3 load configuration, load on the frame. So for that we have to select this frame and assign point load, and we will see, give the name TG3 and the left distance 2.915 16,000 keep, another distance is the 8.915 and another value of 16,000 pound. Add to the existing load. Okay, again for the right vehicle we have to select this frame and assign frame loads, point load, that's group 3, and it should be distance 1 feet and 7 feet. Add to the existing load. Okay, so this is what the load configuration for the traffic group 3 looks like. Now we'll define the load combination. Add new combo. The first one we like to define as only the dead load, that is the 1.25 DC plus 1.5 GW, and for that we have to put the values of 1.25, then adding this one, then curve 1.5, post 1.5, and finally wiring course 1.5. Okay, now another combinations, we know that for the deck we'll do the service limit strength 1. However, you have the 3 traffic groups, so we'll test the service limit strength 1 with each traffic group. Hence we will put here the dead load values, and for the service limit strength all the scale factor is 1. So for the dead load 1, curve 1, post 1, and warning course 1, and we will add only the traffic group 1 here. Okay, now we'll make a copy of this one and put the name service strength service limit state 2. For that, we will use traffic group. Instead of traffic group 1, we will use the traffic group 2. Okay. Then we make a copy of that and put the name service 3. And here, instead of traffic group 2, traffic group 3 here. Okay. Now again, going back to dead loads, we make a copy of that. Now, when you go the strength limit strength, then the factor remains same. With that, we have to put the live loads with a factor of 1.75 plus. It has an impact factor of 33%. So if I multiply 1.75 into 1.33, it comes around 2.33. So I'm adding this one for the strength limit strength 1. Okay. Now make a copy of that and putting the name strength 2 with traffic group 1, changing to traffic group 2. Modify. Okay. Now again, making a copy of that, putting the name strength 3, changing traffic group 2 to traffic group 3. Modify. Okay. So these are the 6-7 combinations we have for analysis. Okay. Now if you want to make the design of the concrete, then we have to select the design compose for the concrete. It will almost the same. So we'll select all these 7 combinations and put it here. Okay. So now we are done with all the input values. Now we'll run the analysis. In this case, the model will not run, except that one we will run all other load cases, and we are running now. So it will take few time for waiting for the result. So before that, I need to save the file, so I am just saving the file with any of the existing names. So analysis is completed. We can see the deflected shape due to dead load only. However, we can check the concrete design for the structure here. We can see the red color over stress indication all over the frame. However, we go to the our analysis result, that is the moment and shear. Selecting the combo or combination case for strength 3, and we want to see the result for the moment 3-3. Show value and diagrams. Okay. This is the moment diagram for the load combination strength 3. You can see the moment diagram on the tension side, however you can change it to the compression side. Taking this one, moment diagram on tension side, then it is already here in tension side, it will come in compression side. Here it comes. So we can also check the moment diagram for the service limit state 3. Selecting service 3, we can see a slightly increase in values. However, similar way we can check the from this dialog box. So this is the shear diagram. We can generate all the values in a tables from this icon. we check the analysis result and the press OK. Then the all the table corresponding to all values of shear moment and torsion will appear. These are the tables. We can export all tables to Excel. You can see a new Excel file has been generated.
Up the forces, shear, torsion, moment, stresses and so on. Now we like to select the load combination tab and selecting the shear column and then finally selecting the moment column. These three columns in a separate Excel file, and from that Excel file we try to find out the maximum values of shear and moment, and from those maximum values showing the diagram of the shear and moment which I am going to.
So for this load configuration we got the moment diagram like this. For this load configuration, we got the moment diagram like this. And for this load configuration, we got the moment diagram like this. And with this diagram, from the generated table, we took all the maximum values of shear and moment and then put it in separate table, and from there we can generate another table, and from there we can chart which looks like this one. We can get the moment along each 2 feet distance from the center line on either side, and from there we can find out the maximum positive and maximum negative moment. Likewise, we can also generate the moment for the bottom flange. We can generate the moment for web, we can generate the shear for web. This is the transverse shear for the deck slab. This is one way of determining the maximum positive and negative moment along the transverse axis. But another way of doing that is to analysis influence line analysis of live load. That I am going to again perform on the from the SAP. In the SAP, from the display button I can generate the show influence lines. From there I select the frame and I put the name of the frame level 11. I'd like to see the frame level 11 is okay, and the relative distance to follow path load point. Just I'm removing the screen a bit and I to determine the influence line value. So this is the frame level 11, the IL value at end of this frame here, which indicates the deck. So its relative distance will be at the almost close to the 1. Okay. And I like to see the IL values for the moment. Okay. So this is the IL of the slab, top slab, at the center line top slab. We can put these values in tabular form. Go to the display again, show the influence lines. You can see here show table.
So I click this one and I will find that the another table will be generated from there. From here I can copy the selected cell. Or I can copy the entire table. And then I can copy those values in Excel file, and from the Excel file again I can generate the charts, which I'm again going to show now. So this was the center line aisle, and the generated chart is like this one. The aisle for the root of the overhang, that chart is like this one. This is the aisle for the inside face of void, and the generated chart is this one. This is the aisle for the top of web, and the generated chart is this one. Now if we combine all the aisles together, the values of aisles generated in table, then we combined more for the entire deck, and this is how you see. From there we can find out the maximum positive moment, and we can find out the maximum negative moment. The maximum positive moment is 2.48 kft per feet, and maximum negative point is 5.03 kft per feet. So basing on those values, we can find out the positive reinforcement, 0.62 inches square per feet, number 5 bar will use at the rate of 16 center to center. And basing on the negative moment, we determine the negative reinforcement, which is number 5 bar at the rate of 4.5 inch center to center. And as per the code, the distribution reinforcement in the longitudinal directions, it should be 220 divided by root over S. Root over S means the effective width of the web, which should be less than 60 per moment. Here it comes 0.34 inches square per feet using number 5 bar at the rate 11 inches. And for the reinforcement of the bottom slab, the course said it should be the 40% of the flange area. For longitudinal reinforcement, it comes 0.27 inches square per feet, and for the transverse reinforcement, it should be 50% of the flange area. Here it comes to the end of our transverse analysis and SAP 2000. Now we are going to do the longitudinal analysis for the design of the girder, and we'll do that in CSIB software. This is CSIBridge version 15.2. Let us first select a blank template. We can follow the bridge wizard, but I prefer to proceed manually. So first select the layout. Then we need to define a layout line. So this is bridge layout line 1, and here we just put the value of initial station is the 0 and end station is the 100, meaning 0 to 100 feet is my span length. Okay. Then we need to define the lens. The first length, length 1. Along the length, the maximum length load discretization length should be 10 feet, and across it should be 2 feet. And the station, it starts 0, then center line 6 feet, and my length width is 12 feet. And the other side, the station will be 100 feet, center line okay, length width okay. Adding this one, you can see the length is right side of the center line. So with this, the left edge of this length is interior and the right edge is the exterior. Okay. Then we make a copy of this length 1. These values will remain same. Here from 0 to 6 it will be minus 6, modify, and this value from 100
fit station, this will be minus 6. I'm modifying this. So this length is the other side of the center line, and the left edge is the exterior and the right edge is the interior. Then we select the next menu components. The material properties 4000 psi is okay. Now the superstructure section. Now we need to select a new section. Since this is a single cell box girder, so we'll select this one. The values you can see here are the values of the given section, but we need to customize that values as per our design. So first we need to see that the span range 30.5 to 45.7 meters, so we fall 100 feet falls within this range. Depth in millimeter, so our depth is 2100 millimeter. Then deck width, our deck width is 9600 millimeters, and we change the unit here in pound. We change the unit in pound inch. And then we need to convert to the to a editable section. So here we can see these values we can now edit. So we will give the inputs as per our typical cross section. So now I'm putting the values. Suppose I like to give the name of the B section as B. And the material properties is okay, 4000, and number of interior girder is 0. Total width we have, however I like to keep a time jump, and like that the viewers see the values after I complete the inputting the values. I have completed the inputting values. In this box you will find the notations are given like F1, F3, F4, F7, F5 this way, and here also you'll find F1, F3, F4 so that you understand in which dimension, in which you have to put what dimensions. And once you complete your inputs, you'll find the corresponding cross sections will appear here with all the coordinates of your frame and the cross section. So we are done. You can see the all the inputs here. So we are done with the design of the cross section. Pressing OK. Next, you need to define the substructure bearing. Though we are designing the superstructures, even though for the boundary conditions, we need to define the bearings. So we have selected the bearings, now making a new bearing, name the BBRG1. Here translation along the layout line L3 we make it free, the others remain same. Okay. Then we go to the next menu, that is loads. So first we need to define the vehicles. Defining a new vehicle, we'll define the HL93M, and its dynamic allowance is 33%. Okay. We like to add another vehicle just to show the dynamic impact of load on the bees. This is not pertinent to our design, even though we like to show the impact of dynamic load on the bees, how the bees deflects due to the load. So again we are selecting the same vehicle, but we are changing some configurations. So this is the vehicle characteristics. Here we like to change the fixed length, we like to put 14 feet. And uniform load We don't want to put any uniform load while we put this vehicle in simulating the dynamic load. So we put all the uniform load zero. And this name of the vehicle is HL93M2. Now we will define a vehicle class. We'll put a new one. We'll add both the vehicle here. Now we'll select the dead load patterns. Already we have the dead load. Now we'll put another load, is the utility load. That is also dead load we consider. And another load we put is the truck, which is only for the seeing the dynamic impact of vehicle. So this is the vehicle life. Then we'll go to the response spectrum function. Response spectrum. So we'll select H2 2007. Okay. Then we'll find a new function named function 1. So we'll keep this function. So here we put function 1 as of the selected function. Then we'll perform the load distribution. First we go to the point loads. So adding new point load definition first. So first point load, we have the post, which is the left side of the deck. So we give the name post left, that is force gravity, and the value is 441.66 pound, and it is located on the left edge of the deck 0.75 feet. Okay. Then we make a copy of that. Now renaming that as the post right, the value remains same, and this time reference location from the right edge of the deck 0.75 feet. Okay. Then we like to define the area load. A new area load. Name it as the car left, that is in PSF. Okay. And the left edge value is 150 PSF and the right edge value is 150 PSF. Reference location from the left edge of the deck, it is 0, and again from the left edge of the deck it should be 4 feet. We make a copy of that and putting the name curve right, same values, this time from the right edge of the deck it should be 4 feet, and from the right edge of the deck it should be 0 feet. Okay. Again we make a copy of that. We have one more area load, that is the wiring surface. So put it WC, and here the value is 1.25 PSF. Now we go to the next menu, bridge, and then we have to select a new bridge object. So this is the bridge object 1 using the bridge layout line 1, and here we have few options which already we have completed few. We'll check it back. Suppose this span here, so through an abutment this section is RCC, it is okay. Then the yaw discretization point, okay, I like to put for every 10 feet, adding this one. Okay, then abutment, we are not designing the abutment bends, super elevation, pistol tendons, girder reverse. We go directly to the point load assignment. So point load is the this was the utility. Point load is the first is the post left. First station 0, spacing 5 feet from post to post, so it will come around 21 post for the whole 100 feet. We make a copy of that, and this time is the post right, and the value remains same. We have only these two point loads. Okay, then no line loads, go to the area load assignment. So again, this load pattern is the utility. Curve left 0 to end station to 100 feet. End station is at 100 feet. And none. Okay, add a copy of that. It is curve right. It will be from 0 to 100 feet. Okay. Then adding a copy of that. This time this is under also utility load pattern. This time we'll put the wiring course, it also from 0 to 100. We are done with the area load assignment. Okay, so far we have given so many inputs, but we don't see any physical existence of such input. So we like to update. So far we have given so many values, so we like to get the update of that. So this is the bridge object 1, and these values is remain okay. And this time we use update as the area object model with 4 feet. Okay, so we can see here is our bridge. We have given the input of our cross sections and various load assignment. We are yet left with few other inputs. Now we are going to the analysis menu. The types here, we'll select the moving load. So we will create two moving load 1 and the lens. So we are creating a new one will follow single lens, and moving load 2 will follow both the lens. So putting the name of first one, moving load 1. The code says that if there is a single lens, then it will be multiplied by 1.2. so modifying this one, we are using the vehicle class 1 with scale factor minimum load lens 1 and maximum total length is 1, adding this one. Okay, making a copy of that. So everything remains same, namely moving load 2. Here also only we change it, minimum loaded length is 2 and maximum loaded length is 2. Modify this one. Another assignment which is not very much pertinent to our analysis, that is the time history, to see the dynamic impact of the vehicles on the. So we are making a new time history load case, giving its name as dynamic time history. We will select the direct integration. load applied. Load name is the truck. And this is the default functions developed by the CSIBridge software, the ramp function. We are adding this one. Number of output time steps, we put the value 320, and output time step size 0.05. Everything is okay. We are done with the analysis menu. Then again, going back to the load menu, here we have the load patterns. This input we have to give only for to see the dynamic impact track. We are modifying the base live load. And in this case, for the impact, dynamic impact, we will use these vehicles, 93M2, for the lane 1, start distance 0, start time 0, for all directions, we put a vehicle speed of 75 feet per second, adding this one. The another vehicle will follow through in the same lane, same, but it will cross the road after say 3 seconds, forward direction, and with the speed of 150 feet per second. Another vehicle, it will pass through the point after 4 seconds with the speed of 250 feet per second. Adding this one. Additionally, one over the two one. Now consider the another vehicle at 6 seconds time. After 6 seconds, it will cross the road with a speed of say very high speed, 300 feet per second. And the duration of the loading is 10 seconds. Discretization every 0.05 second. Okay, in this configuration we like to see how that have the dynamic impact on our bridge. Okay. Now we go to the design and rating menu. So now we'll have the combination, load combinations, putting the default values here. So we'll set the load combination data. Okay. So we'll check only the strength limit state 1 and service limit state 1. Others we are unchecking those. Pressing OK now. Now we'll find automatically the default load combination will appear in. So you can see the various load combination, the strength group, various load combination. Suppose if I select this one, you want to see what is. We can see this one. So this is dead load 1.25, it is 1.25, and ML2 1.75 for that combinations. So we have used the computer generated, code generated default load combination for our longitudinal analysis. Now checking the code difference. This CSIBridge support ASTO LRFD 2007 code. Okay. Then superstructure design request. While doing the analysis, we like to make some request that we want the results related to, like we are making a request to give the result of shear, moment and stress. Suppose the name of the request is the request 1, and we like to make a request for the request 1 to give the result of the concrete box shear, and pressing OK. And adding another request, the request 2, for giving the result about the concrete box flexure, I mean the moment, and pressing OK. And I like to make another request for the generation of the box stress. So the request 3 stands for the concrete box stress. So we have made 3 requests. One is the shear, another was the moment, and the final stress of the box girder. Now we'll go to the advanced step. Here also for the concrete we have to select, but so here we are selecting this service and strength, all default load combinations was automatically generated. We are adding this here. There was a problem here selecting the files, so we are doing again. Now adding all those load combinations for the concrete design also. Okay, so we are done with all the inputs. Now we will run analysis. So we don't want the model case to be run, so I said the do not run this case and run others. So it will take couple of times, so we are also making a time jump here. Meanwhile we forgot to save the file, so we are saving this file in longitudinal video file in the existing file name. So analysis is performed successfully. Now we have to run another analysis to perform the design request, superstructure design request. We are running that analysis now. So we have these 3 requests, and now we'll perform the analysis on those requests. So the request has been performed successfully, and you can see the result displayed on the screen. The request 1 was for the shear, so you can see the shear diagram here. And there is an option demand / capacity limit. If you check it here, so understand my demand limit lies here, and some portion, some of the, this is my capacity line, above the capacity line. So these are the blue lines is the demand lines, and this orange line is the my capacity line. Similarly, we can check the request 2, which is for the moment. Here we can see the moment diagram, moment envelope. This is shown in the tension site. We can change it in the options. And finally, if you want to see the request 3 for the stress, can see the stress envelope. You can also get all those in the table. As you can see, like the transverse analysis, so this table is the stress table, and here we can also get all the data. And we can put all the data, the required data, we can take it in the Excel, and from the Excel we can generate the charts. So these were the data related to the box stress. We can same table, we can get the same table. We can change the settings, that is the showing that is showing the moment diagram in compression site, modify show other setting. And we can uncheck this one, the moment diagram on tension side. Okay. Now to see the other results, you can go to the home button and we can see these are the result buttons. First one is the deform shape. If you want to see the deform shape for the moving load, suppose moving load 1 and we see the we can see the deflection patterns due to moving load 1 and the value is given in pound feet, put it in inch. So we had a limitation on the deflections. The course said that the maximum permissible live load deflection will be the length of the span divided by 800 feet. So our length is 100 feet multiplied by 12 to make it an inch, so it becomes 1200 feet divided by 800, it comes 1.5 inch. So maximum permissible deflection for our base is 1.5 inch, and here we find that the maximum deflection is 0.405 inch. So we are in the safe side. This is says if the load is moving load 1, so we need to check again for moving load 2. So we are giving the moving load 2 and checking the result. Let's see what does it comes. It is 0.401. So we are our base is safe as far as the limit on deflection is concerned. Our base is safe. Now we can see the other analysis result from here. Suppose for the case or combo, we like to put it the strength limit, strength group 1. Now selecting for the only the left exterior girder, and this is the moment 3 diagram for the left exterior girder. We can put the values in k feet. That will give the reasonable understanding about the values. Then this is the moment diagram for the left exterior girder. We can see the shear force for the left exterior girder. We can see the torsion for the left exterior girder, and likewise we can generate all the values and tables, and from the tables we can take it in the Excel file, and from the Excel file we can find out by comparing all the combinations which one gives the highest values. We take the highest values and we can generate Excel charts, which I am going to show now. So this is the longitudinal shear force at the girders. From this value we can very well understand what is the shear, the span at the beginning of the span, and what is the shear at the center of the span, and basing on that we can very well design the stirrup. So basing on the shear force, we have calculated the stirrup area, and then we have designed the shear reinforcements. This is the longitudinal moment envelope at the girder, and basing on the moment diagram we understand what will be the longitudinal girder reinforcement, and we have designed accordingly. So this is the steel area basing on the generated design moment, and this is the number of bars in accordance with the design moment. And finally, this is the desired output of our two analyses. This one is we obtain
from the transverse analysis, this is the deck reinforcement. The upper one, lower one is the transverse reinforcement, and this one is the longitudinal reinforcement. And at the bottom slab also, we obtain the value from the transverse analysis. And these values, the reinforcement of the girders and the shear reinforcement, we have obtained from the longitudinal analysis. So these are the final outputs, and we could successfully accomplish our design by performing transverse and longitudinal analysis in SEP 2000 version 15 and 15.2. Finally, I like to show you the dynamic impact of the vehicle on the bridge part of our analysis. We will try to show in a video. So here, from pictures, we will create a multi-step animation video. So first, we'll select here the dynamic load case, and we'll end time. We'll like to give only 10-second run. Time increment will have 0.2 second, and the magnification factor for better understanding of the deflection, we are just magnifying the deflection rate. Suppose we are making 400, we like to show the others. Okay, now pressing okay, and then sorry viewers, could not show you the animated video properly due to weak processor. However, here we come to the end of our video presentation. While doing the design, we had few limitations. Suppose we did the design only for the superstructures. And while doing the manual design, we have taken our design code as the ASTO LRFD 2012. But while doing the software modeling, like SAP 2000 version 15, they support ASTO 2000, and CSIBridge version 15.2, they support ASTO LRFD 2007. So there was a little bit of limitations in this aspect. And whenever we see a box girder, these are the pre-stress box girders. But since we are designing this box girder, because we need to make a prototype of this, and in the prototype base we cannot accommodate the pre-stressing equipment, that's why we have designed only the plain RCC box girders. This design was performed in fulfillment the course requirement of C411, and it was performed by the members of Group 2 C14 Civil Engineering Department, Military Institute of Science and Technology, in short MIST. We hope that this will help the novice modelers like us. Thank you very much.